By the end of the 1980s, electric vehicles had taken baby steps towards becoming practical, and companies would continue to produce small lightweight vehicles into the 1990s using heavy lead-acid batteries. But one company would strive, and some would say succeed, in producing the world's first electric vehicle that was a practical replacement for an internal combustion engine car. It would take almost 10 years of work to produce and would come from the unlikeliest of sources, stodgy old General Motors. This is the General Motors EV1 story. In the 1990s, many electric cars were produced, but these had evolved little since the 1980s, using lead-acid batteries and simple motors and drivetrains. The car's glacial acceleration was measured over 0 to 30 miles an hour, as many of them couldn't even get to 60 miles an hour. The EV1 was truly a car apart, and the story starts with the GM Sun Racer, developed in 1987 in collaboration with AeroVironment and the Hughes Aircraft Company. To win the race, an innovative new motor utilizing rare earth metals was produced, being 92% efficient and lighter to boot. Buoyed by the win, General Motors started a program to build a test car that they might turn into a practical electric car. The result was the 1990 GM Impact. Probably not the best name you can give for a car. But the car used much improved electronics that regulated the motor and its lead-acid batteries. Instead of using low voltage direct current like most electric cars before it, the Impact switched to high voltage alternating current that was much more efficient. It required investment in an inverter to translate the DC into AC, making for a much more complex drivetrain. GM began a testing program with the Impact in 1994, loaning them to 50 members of the public for 1 to 2 weeks. The testers needed to have a garage where the necessary charging equipment could be installed. The interest in the program was overwhelming, with 10,000 people calling in from around Los Angeles and 14,000 people from the New York City area before lines had to be closed. Customer and car magazine reviews were both favorable, with Motor Trend finding it a revelation, writing, "The Impact is precisely one of those occasions where GM proves beyond any doubt that it knows how to build fantastic automobiles. This is the world's only electric vehicle that drives like a real car." General Motors, the stodgy company known for uninspiring cars by the 1990s, had made the first electric car that was a viable family car replacement. To show just how fast it was, a modified Impact set an EV land speed record of 183 miles an hour that same year. Yet in the New York Times article, GM itself poured cold water on the whole endeavor, saying they'd come up short. With such enthusiasm, why would they sabotage their own car? Well, there are various likely reasons. The first is the practicality of the car. The car had a limited range, just a few tens of miles, and took an age to recharge. In a big country like the USA, where people think nothing of driving for hours to get to the next city, this didn't really seem like a practical mass-market car. The second reason was likely the cost. GM produces affordable cars, and they believed it would cost a lot to produce. But likely the main reason had come from the state of California. In the early 1990s, they'd heard of GM's Impact Test Program and brought in legislation from CARB, or the California Air Resources Board, ruling that the top 7 automakers had to make 2% of all cars it sold in California emission-free by 1998. This would rise to 5% in 2000 and 10% in 2003. GM and other car makers were aghast at how much this would cost them to develop. Putting more money into R&D means lower profits, which means the company's share price dips. Plus, making 10% of all GM cars sold in California emission-free in just 10 years seemed pretty far-fetched. The technology to produce the cars hadn't yet been created. Looking back, it does seem like an impossible task, when there were less than 0.5% of zero-emission cars on the road in the USA by 2019. So by striving to innovate in the market, GM had kicked over a hornet's nest, so we're now desperately trying to dampen expectations on the EV excitement, while at the same time starting work to challenge the CARB legislation in the Californian courts. In GM's eyes, the Impact was a nice test project, but the electric car wasn't ready for the mass market anytime soon. California pointed out the vast popularity of their test program and told them to get on with making zero-emission cars a reality. Despite GM's concerns, their EV program continued, and the car evolved into the 1996 EV1, the first production car in General Motors' 88-year history to wear the GM badge. The car used a lighter aluminium frame, with plastic body panels, super light magnesium alloy wheels, and had a low drag factor of just 0.19, all to help get the most performance and range from its heavy 533kg lead acid batteries. The three-phase AC motor produced 137 horsepower with no need to change gears, and the front-wheel drive car had a range of around 80 miles, but like with any electric car, hills and cold weather would eat into that range. GM decided it would have a limited release in Phoenix and Tucson in Arizona, plus Los Angeles. They were quick to highlight the benefits of an electric car: no oil changes, no tune-up, so no expensive servicing. With most people driving less than 80 miles a day and home charging taking just 3 hours and a 9-second 0-60 time, GM sold this as an everyday practical car. To get into the car, the driver used a keypad and entered an unlock code on the center console to start the car. The EV1 had all the modern conveniences you'd expect, like airbags, CD player, cruise control, and air conditioning. The cars could only be leased, so they remained the property of General Motors. They were initially offered to influencers like Hollywood celebrities and politicians, something that GM would live to regret, and all potential owners would be pre-screened. Leases were high, between $400 and $550 a month, when you could lease a Honda Accord at that time for around $230 a month. Despite GM's reticence about the car, they put $8 million of advertising behind the launch, showing GM's ability to lead the market with its first modern electric car. But with each EV1 having to be essentially hand-built, in the first 12 months of release, they'd only leased 288 cars. But those 288 drivers had wonderfully maniacal loyalty, according to EV1 brand manager Ken Stewart. After GM's initial marketing push, the advertising stopped, which got EV1 drivers spooked. One such person was Marvin Rush, a cinematographer on the TV show Star Trek Voyager, who got so worried he made his own radio ad and paid $20,000 of his own money to get it on air. GM was initially taken aback and opposed what he'd done, but later changed its mind, saying it would make the ads official and reimburse him the $20,000. But as GM continued to fight California's CARB legislation in court, many felt that at best GM was conflicted about selling its EV1, and at worst had already given up. But EV1 development continued. GM had always wanted the original car to have lighter and more powerful nickel metal hydride batteries, and these were added to the quieter 1999 Gen 2 car. This made it approximately 80 kilograms lighter and improved the range from about 80 miles to 140. Over the next 2 years, about 200 Gen 1 cars were retrofitted with the improved batteries. During the initial market analysis of the EV1, GM had identified that the two-seat layout was a limiting factor, so they produced a four-seat prototype by stretching the car by 19 inches. The heavier chassis limited the range to just 50 miles, so it wasn't used for the 1996 EV1, but they would use it in 1998 to showcase alternate propulsion technologies. The first was a series hybrid, using a gas turbine engine in the boot, which could be powered by regular petrol or compressed natural gas. When the EV1's batteries needed charging, the engine would start, providing the necessary power. The second was a parallel hybrid, using a 1.3-litre turbo diesel engine to power a DC motor that powered the rear wheels, while the existing batteries and AC motor powered the front wheels. The 0-60 time was just 7 seconds, with a total power output of 219 horsepower. GM would use similar hybrid technology on the Opel Astra diesel hybrid concept in 2005. The third used a methanol-powered fuel cell, an expander compressor, and a fuel processor which was allied to the EV1's batteries and motor. This gave the car a range of around 300 miles. The last didn't use batteries at all. Instead, it used a compressed natural gas tank allied to a 1-litre Suzuki 3-cylinder engine, giving it a 0-60 time of 11 seconds. The tank could be filled in about 4 minutes to give a range of up to 400 miles. By 1999, GM had also reduced the production costs of the vehicle, although they were still not being mass produced. Just 457 were produced in the first 12 months after the Gen 2's release, and GM ended production in 1999 after producing just 1,117 cars. At the time, they said they just couldn't make the car for a profit. In 2002, General Motors notified all those driving EV1s that their leases wouldn't be renewed and that all the cars would be taken off the road. There was a public outcry from the leaseholders who loved their cars and wanted to keep driving them. GM said that it wasn't possible to renew the leases as they couldn't supply replacement parts for the 15-year life of the vehicle, which California required them to do. Some offered to buy the cars outright and wrote up contracts absolving GM of any requirements to supply replacement parts. Some went as far as to post checks with a deposit. GM refused and returned all the checks. EV1 owners were outraged, and one in particular, executive producer Chris Payne, decided to direct a documentary chronicling the end of the EV1, and it ended up being a scathing attack on GM. He called it Who Killed the Electric Car? And if you want to go into more detail on the history of the EV1, it's well worth a watch. General Motors stuck to its guns and took back all the EV1s, threatening leaseholders with legal action if they refused. Most were crushed, but 39 were deactivated and donated to museums. One lucky EV1 wasn't deactivated because the beneficiary, the Smithsonian Museum of Washington DC, would only take it if it was still drivable. This makes the EV1, a car from the end of the 20th century, a rarer car than many cars from the early part of the 20th century. GM's reluctance and the resulting documentary destroyed all the goodwill they created with the EV1. Honda, in contrast, bowed to customer pressure with its similar EV Plus program and allowed customers to extend their leases. The auto companies managed to get California to abandon the CARB legislation, which wasn't going to be practical in any case, but it spurred many automakers to look into alternate propulsion methods. Toyota and Honda launched the Prius and Insight hybrids, with small battery packs being charged by a regular internal combustion engine. And Japanese manufacturers in particular invested in hydrogen fuel cell technology, which they continue to work on to the present day. Hybrid technology became very fashionable after the Prius and Insight were launched, but it made very little impact on regular internal combustion engine car sales, peaking at just 3.2% of cars sold in the USA in 2013. Some of the people who worked on the GM Impact prototype started AC propulsion in 1992. They would focus on electric drivetrains, which would be used on the Tesla Roadster prototype, and they continue to sell their products today. In 2009, outgoing GM CEO Rick Wagoner said his biggest regret was killing the EV1 and missing the growth of EVs and hybrids. GM would attempt to make up for lost ground by using its EV1 knowledge with their high-profile plug-in hybrid car, the Chevy Volt, and GM touted this car would bring them back to profitability after its 2009 bankruptcy. The car was the poster child for the new GM, but it failed to capture public interest, and GM went back to making profitable petrol-powered trucks as the economy recovered from the global recession. In 2020, there's a land rush amongst large car companies towards creating electric vehicles, with Volkswagen hoping to sell 1 million EVs by 2023, and BMW delivering its 500,000th electric car at the end of December in 2019. The EV1 was a seminal car, the first practical electric car, but maybe a car before its time. How were people texting each other in the 1930s? Find out more in my little car video about the telex. And a big thank you to all my patrons for supporting me. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next video.